Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Sir, your microphone. Mute. You are mute, sir.
Hello. Welcome, Vajpayee. Very good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Ashutosh, good afternoon. Good afternoon to everybody who have joined. So, Manvind, how are you?
Manvindar, you are muted. You are muted. Manvindar is muted.
Yeah. So, Ashutosh, you can start now.
Sure, sir.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is my utmost pleasure to welcome and introduce today's distinguished guest of honor and speaker, Professor G.S. Vajpayee. Sir, I welcome you on behalf of Dharamsas National Law University, Jabalpur. We are also in esteemed presence of our Professor Balraj Chauhan, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, who will chair today's session. Sir, I welcome you on behalf of faculty members and students attending this session. Before we delve deep into today's academic discussions, I would like to briefly introduce our guest of speaker, Professor G.S. Vajpayee, for all those attending the session. Sir is an esteemed academician, a learned author, a brilliant researcher, as well as an able administrator. Besides holding the office of registrar at National Law University, Delhi, he serves as professor of criminology and criminal justice, chair professor at K.L. Arora Chair in Criminal Law at National Law University, Delhi, and also as the chairperson at Center for Criminology and Victimology. Professor Vajpayee has authored 18 books and more than 80 papers, more than 36 op-eds in the leading dailies like Indian Express, The Hindu, The Tribune, etc., and 12 project reports and several monographs. Professor Vajpayee has held many prestigious international assignments for advanced research in criminal law and criminal justice. In recognition of his contribution to the growth of criminology in India, Sir was conferred the title of Fellow of Indian Society of Criminology by the Indian Society of Criminology. He was also awarded Professor S. Srivastava Memorial Award for Excellence in Research and Teaching in Criminology and Best Social Scientist Award of the Indian Society of Criminology. He was also conferred the prestigious Professor K. Chokalingam Award in 4th International and 8th Biennial Conference of the Indian Society of Victimology in October 2014. Recently, Professor Vajpayee was also conferred upon the ISC Kumarappa Reckless Award, the highest honor and award of ISC, in recognition of significant contribution to research, teaching, and administration in field of criminal justice administration, and the list goes on. Sir, I thank you for accepting our humble invitation to take out some time for the session out of your schedule, and once again, welcome you to DNLU lecture series on critical criminal law. I now request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to say a few words and introduce the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ashutosh. Like all of you, I also want to listen to Vajpayee on this very important topic. And as you all know, that he is one of the prominent criminologists, not only of the India, but of the world. At a global level, his work has been recognized and he has toured many countries. So it's a good opportunity for all of us to hear about critical criminal law, and he's going to discuss the theories of the critical criminal law. LLM students, I think it's compulsory for you to attend this session, and I would like to have your comments, and if you have any doubt, then you can clear them before Vajpayee will leave. But I assure you one thing, I'm happy that whenever I request him, he always give me favor and always do what I'm asking from him. But this is the time of eminence, importance, and value for you. Concentrate, focus, and listen to him attentively. I welcome Vajpayee. It's a pleasure for all of us. And I will say that these students are lucky to have you as their teacher, lecturer, discussant today on this very important topic, on which a lot of, you see, confusion is there. So on behalf of the DNLU fraternity, I extend you a very warm welcome, and over to you, G.S. Vajpayee.
Very good afternoon to all of you. My special regards to Professor Chauhan for his generous remarks and introduction, and also the organizers, Association, Manvendra, ITC, and other faculty colleagues, and all the students who are today present for this lecture. My talk today, I hope I have like around 1 hour, or what kind of time do we have for this?
You can speak. You see, topic is such that you can speak as you like.
But we have to sort of keep some time. So let me see. The idea of this entire talk is to introduce the whole idea of critical criminal law as to what are the originating ideas in the theory of critical criminal law, how the body of critical criminal law was constructed, and what are the important, prominent, jurisprudential, and critical underpinnings on the notion of critical criminal law. That is how I am going to start. But before I start, it is my duty to tell you, criminal law, as you all know, that what is criminal law? So mostly the nature of criminal law is normative. Normative criminal law means the textual criminal law that we have. So what is the prefix critical? Critical means what exactly we are trying to sort of see through the criticality or critical perspective. The idea of criticality was borrowed from critical legal studies tradition. As you all know, that in late 70s, the critical legal study movement, CLS, was started in Wisconsin, US. There they have tried to go behind the law in order to understand the different kind of, background ideas in the criminal law, rather than merely having a simple introduction of criminal law or normative criminal law. They wanted to understand that what are the important understanding about the effects of criminal law, about the origin of criminal law, about the history of criminal law, about the making of criminal law. So they brought several discussion into it. What I am going to do, it is very difficult to sort of very clearly identify this whole, because this is a very emerging area, as Professor Chauhan knows very well. He has such a season. It's my privilege that I am speaking before a giant criminal law scholar on a subject which is in itself sort of in the making at the moment. But what I will do is, I'll try to bring a lot of ideas which form the whole theory of critical criminal law. So I'll briefly introduce those ideas, and I have a small PPT also, which I'll share so that the students may also sort of record certain things which are the part of that too. So I am doing the screen sharing. Can you allow me the screen sharing?
Yes, sir. We are on it, sir.
I can't see the button here. Yes, I'm sharing this. My first line is that critical criminal law is all about looking at criminal law from a theoretical, functional, and historical perspective by applying philosophical and radical linings. So basically, Andrew Ashworth has written about the historic critique of criminal law, and he was of the view that if you want to understand the context of criminal law, the originating ideas lie within the historical thing. I'll elaborate on these three areas: functional, historical, and theoretical. And second issue is very important, because the contours of normative analysis. Normative analysis means the simple criminal law that we have, black letter criminal law. And the institutional analysis. So sometimes mostly we are occupied with the normative understanding of the criminal law without understanding the institutional institutions of criminal law. So in when we discuss the critique of criminal law, we are essentially, we will be talking about the institutions of criminal law also, which include the police and other agencies. And third is the debate is also between the two things, because in traditional understanding, we are largely confined into the legal formalism. Legal formalism is the formal structure of the law, all black letter law, textual criminal law, the provisions of criminal law. So when legal realism is contrasted with legal formalism, we are instantly drifting into the territory of criminal law. Because discussing legal realism means we are essentially interested in the context of criminal law. So basically the rhetoric of criminal law is very important, and there we see how the criminal law is applied and what kind of consequences arise. So this debate is basically taken from the CLS tradition, critical legal studies tradition. Because the conventional criminal law up to 17th in the late 17th in the US was confined to the legal formalism. So what is formally written or formally contained in the body of criminal law was the whole structure of criminal law. But people have started trying to understand that how criminal law is applied. Because a lot of allegations are made that there is a selective enforcement of laws. When we talk about the context of the criminal law, then we are getting into. So I think I would like the student to probably underline the debate between legal formalism and legal realism. Because in my all other slides and other further talking points, this mostly I'll confine to this understanding. Another thread which is very critical in the entire debate on criminal law is criminal law is a communication. Because I think this is very important. Paul Robinson actually is a very prominent functionalist. We call functional criminal law scholar in the US and Pennsylvania University. He said the entire manifestation of criminal law becomes apparent when it interacts. When it interacts people, when it interacts with the society, when it addresses the society. So in that sense, criminal law is a communication. This is a fantastic line. Because it communicates the wrongdoing, wrongfulness, harmfulness, and reaction to harmfulness. Now, so these are very important debates. Now, another theoretical underpinning that I have already mentioned, that law and context and normative law debate, that is the part of basically the legal formalism and legal realism. But also the issue is, what are the several external factors which influence the functioning of criminal law in an institution? Now, generally what has happened that criminal law, the traditional scholarship of criminal law is confined within the criminal law. But criminal law, the applications of criminal law also have an important bearing of several external factors which are non-legal factors. So there are non-legal factors, there are non-legal actors. They influence, like for instance, there is a general debate as to what extent the media has an influence on the sentencing process or the quantum of punishment. So do we have this kind of understanding whether now the study that has been conducted in the National Law University Delhi on lower court dispositions on death penalty issue, they have come out with this that the judges were mainly attending to the all of social conscience. So they were doing the death penalty sentencing based on social conscience. So they were thinking, what is the expectations of the society? So how the social expectations are decodified, it is a purely external considerations in the adjudication of a case. So my whole idea of saying the operation of criminal law does have some crucial importance and the bearing of several external factors. Another thing which is very important is in the realm of critical criminal law, we need to understand the limits of criminal law. Probably we have come to this understanding that criminal law is a very powerful arm of the state. And the debate goes that the misuse of criminal law by the state machinery is quite, you know, visible. Now you can see in all crucial situations, whenever the state want to regulate the people and public, they use criminal law. Even in lockdown, you have seen thousands of people were confined to jail, temporary or permanent. Those things are different. But that thing is very important. Now, limits of criminal law thesis is a very critical analysis of criminal law in terms of its selective application. So we are all aware of the crime control model and Herbert Packer. Here I would introduce Herbert Packer. Herbert Packer is a very important facet of critical criminal law, because we need to understand what is the direction of criminal law. It is said that when 1973 CRPC was amended, it was largely focused on due process model, because we were talking about the speedy justice, we were talking about the rights of the accused, we were talking about several other due process entitlements and protection. Now, that 73 criminal law has drifted to more and more into crime control model. We have brought UAPA, we have brought lot of civil laws where we have added the criminal law dimension, like for instance triple talaq, environmental crime we are ready to punish. I think criminal law student must be assigned to analyze the emerging trends of criminal law, to the extent it departs from being a completely due process model to become a crime control model kind of. I think the students must understand, when I say due process model, I am essentially talking about the complete reliance of the black letter law in terms of protecting the rights of the accused or rights of other stakeholders. Whereas the crime control model goes to the practicalities of crime law enforcement, where probably the custodial torture is endorsed or other forms of extra legal methods are approved. So probably, I think if you debate this particular issue, you are actually getting into the terrain of critical criminal law. Because then the moment you are ready to analyze the consequence of criminal law or its enforcement in certain way, you have moved away from the normative understanding of criminal law to become a contextual understanding of criminal law. Because how it is influencing the people, how it is being applied. So that is very important. Now, the notion of criminal law, actually there is not a single theory or a single person. It is basically a collectivity. So I have borrowed a lot of ideas from several writings. There are several scholars who have contributed in it. So whenever we are ready to look at the other side of the law enforcement, it means we are trying to look at the critical legal studies. So I have mentioned here that this philosophical foundation of criminal law and its institutions. So the basic idea has been CLS. And I am also saying, as long as the law exists to support the interest of the party or class that forms it, and it is merely a collection of beliefs and prejudices that legitimize the injustices in the society. Means there are people whose interests are associated with the certain kind of enforcement. Because there are lots of allegations now, for instance, in the recent past we have seen in case of the law enforcement with regard to vulnerable people, like JNU happened, Jamia happened, then mob lynching happened, then CA came. So there was a kind of discomfort amongst many classes, many people, and they were thinking that there is a selective enforcement. So how the power interests are getting located and getting aligned in the enforcement of criminal law, that analysis becomes very, very important. I hope that you will recall a very important sentence which I would mention. N.G. Ashworth says that criminal law has to be a last resort. So invoking criminal law, because the application of criminal law has serious implications to the individual freedom, liberty, and dignity. Therefore, Andrew Ashworth says criminal law ought to be a last resort. When you do not have anything left, you should invoke criminal law. So it is very critical. Now, I also say that the work of these three scholars is very important as far as human law is concerned. Paul Robinson is a functionalist in the field of human law, who says that the function of criminal law is very, very important in a society. He said a range of coercive methods available to modern state for legitimizing its political gains. Now, this is something very important. So, when criminal law functions for these kinds of objectives, political end, because political executive is the controller of the criminal law. This is very important because they are in the power. They can give certain direction. Like, I think in the classroom situation, the teacher ought to ask certain questions to the student looking at the contemporary developments. Like, for instance, decision to criminalize. How a conduct is criminalized? What are the decision making? Because generally, our teaching traditions do not involve the questioning the making of criminal law. We never question. We accommodate and we adjust and we accept criminal law as it is. But like, for instance, this epidemic-related amendments were recently made by this government, where they have decided to penalize. Every order of MHA regarding lockdown contains the penal provisions in the event of violation. And in several non-criminal situations, you will find the citizens' conduct is to be regulated by the force of criminal. So sometimes political ends become very, very important. Therefore, it becomes very, very critical. I remember, if you go to the critical legal tradition, the famous work by him, he says that criminal law is a politics. And therefore, the critique of criminal procedure and other kinds of law is something that we have to look into. Now, historical critique is very important. So first we have to look at the normative critique. Then we have to look at the functional critique. And the third, we have to look at the historical. These three critiques, I'm saying this to make it easy for the student. So they can start with normative critique, whether the provisions of law really address the kind of objectives which are proposed to be achieved by these laws or not. I think a very critical analysis can be made on this. And similarly, the functional critique which I have to get. Historical critique, there is a book by Alan Noray, I recommend that, Crime, History and Reason. This book is a Bible. Crime, History and Reason. In the opening page of this book, Alan is saying that the roots of criminal law, which is imperative to locate the inherent, irrational and unjustified structural aspects of criminal law. And he also says that a particular kind of society generates a particular historical form of social control peculiar to itself. So he said criminal law has lots of historical influences. Like you can easily say, when Macaulay devised the Indian Penal Code for India, he has a different kind of understanding about criminal law for a country like India. At the same time, he was also formulating a law for the UK, the Great Britain. He has made law very different from that of India, though the person was, because he has studied Indian society very deep. That's why at that point of time, he criminalizes adultery, he criminalizes homosexuality, he criminalizes many things which we have recently decriminalized. Now, let us understand that what were the demands at the contemporary society at that point of time and what happened now. So, historical. So, please, I think I would request the law teachers, the criminal law teachers, to please give a short introduction to the student about the making of IPC. I think you have two very important references. One is a paper by Professor D.B. Pandey, Context of Criminal Law and Making of IPC. And another, there is a very good book by Richard Berry and Stanley Leo. Stanley Leo and Richard Berry, they both in Hong Kong, they have researched the making of IPC. And they have come to know, then they were quite influenced by the Alan Moore, and they have endorsed what Alan Moore was saying, that particular society generates a particular criminal. So Indian criminal law or Indian penal code has to be looked into the kind of society it needs to apply the criminal law. And also the general principle of criminal law are the result of social and political struggle and contradictions. Because in India, we have, like, for instance, what are the major and mainstream debates in criminal law in India? We always struggle to pinpoint one very important thing, the rights of vulnerable people, how the criminal law would apply to vulnerable section, to Dalit class, weaker section, women, children, and other kinds of people who are lesser advantaged, who are poor, and what is the speedy justice. These debates are not very prominent in other places. Of course, gender is there, but the vulnerable class, because primarily the societal structure and the diversities and other things are not similar that we have. Another thing is very important is, I'm skipping certain points because they are available on the. I was coming when we look at the normative critique. I have already mentioned the normative critique means we are trying to look into the why of the law. How many of us ask the student why of the criminal law? Why a particular provision? Why a particular act is criminalized by the state? Because normative criminal law debate doesn't allow us to ask this question. But if you are getting into the terrain of critical criminal law, why becomes essential? So we have to answer why the homosexuality was criminalized, what was the notion of adultery being criminalized, or what are the criminal responsibility notions, or why the general defenses and general exceptions are like that. So a lot of things. So limits of criminal law from the lenses of over-criminalization. Now, over-criminalization is a very associated issue. Douglas Hussack has written a very fantastic book titled Overcriminalization. And overcriminalization becomes a very important standpoint to explore critical criminal law in India. Overcriminalization means when unprincipled criminalization means when the regard to the fundamental principles of wrongdoing are ignored. I would again request the teachers and the students also, if you need to understand the decision to criminalize by the state, this debate, you know, goes back to that Devlin and Hart debate. I think Devlin and Hart debate is now very well documented. It is available on JSTOR. If you want to know the students that how a conduct becomes criminalized by the state, how the state takes a decision to criminalize a particular conduct, like we have criminalized recently a lot of things. So nobody looks at nor the principles of criminalization are ever discussed. I remember when Wolfenden Committee report came in the UK, the first reaction by Lord Devlin was that it is not proper to decriminalize homosexual. He was against this. And he has said, criminal law is the reservoir of the social morality. Now, this is a very difficult and complex question, the extent to which the criminal law is the repository of social morality in a society. But he was of the opinion that apart from regulating the conduct of an individual, the criminal law ought to regulate the morality and answer the moral questions in the society. Now, Devlin's remark created a lot of reactions, and Hart has responded. So Hart was the, you know, hardcore follower of J.S. Mill. And J.S. Mill has propounded the principle of harmfulness for a conduct being criminalized. So Hart says it is none of the duty of the criminal law to look at the morality. And it is the harmfulness of the conduct which should become the sole agent of standpoint of taking decision to criminalize the conduct. Now, this complex question you can raise to your student also, the extent Now, a third person came into picture who has rationalized this entire idea. He was Joel Fernweh. Joel Fernweh was from, he was from Germany. Joel Fernweh has written two volumes, Moral Limits of Criminal Law 1 and Moral Limits of Criminal Law 2. Now, Moral Limits of Criminal Law is a Bible. I think it's a fantastic balancing of the debate of Devlin and Hart. And in Moral Limits of Criminal Law, I can refer. He was saying very interesting thing. He said, it is not proper to leave this debate like this. He said there are two very important things. Apart from an act being harmful, it should also be wrongful. So harmfulness and wrongfulness. So Fernweh has added the idea of wrongfulness. Wrongfulness is very different from harmfulness. And he has elaborated this thing. And harmfulness is a very personal interference in the autonomy of the person. Whereas wrongfulness is something which results into the invasions of somebody's rights. So when an act becomes causes violations on the part of somebody's right, then the law has to come into action. So then criminal law has rationalized that criminal law will interfere the moral question to the extent it becomes violative of somebody's rights. And that is why the Supreme Court, when Nauteh Johar or Joseph Stein, they have brought back this idea of moral worth very powerfully. And they are saying that the decision to criminalize must be based on some of these ideas. Because unprincipled criminalization leads to what Douglas Cusack is saying, over-criminalization. Any discussion on critical criminal law ought to involve the over-criminalization. And over-criminalization is no longer a very simple sort of expression, because his work is very clearly critiquing the state, the intention of the state. Like, for instance, you must have noticed I have written an article some months back on UAPA amendment. I don't remember the exact section. But UAPA amendment now empowers the police to declare somebody as potential terrorist. Now, this should not simply go unnoticed, because declaring somebody as potential terrorist based on some evaluation only done by the police, and then police can act in that matter and arrest the person, and because he's a potential terrorist. Actus reus is not important. I don't know what happened, but that is there. So these are the avenues of over-criminalization. So a lot of things are happening. Even that triple talaq thing, one would not be able to reconcile that the extent to which the reach of criminal law should be there in civil jurisdiction. Now, this is another issue. Let us see what are the other things. Now, Allen says the idea of distributive justice, that is distributing punishment according to an offender's blameworthiness, is highly critical in assigning criminal liability and dispensing justice. He's saying distributing punishment. Distributing punishment means the identification of blameworthy act and distribution of punishment according to the blameworthiness. Now, we have to see this is a very sort of a critical observation, because generally it is not happening. Distribution of punishment, because forms of punishments are also sometimes very irrationally applied. Because now our laws, because IPC is completely structured on minimum and maximum punishment thesis. Now we have introduced a minimum sentence. So now certain offenses would attract the minimum punishment. So now these things are very, very important. So deserved punishment idea and the community's shared intuition of justice shall be acknowledged and engaged while reforming any criminal justice system. What is community's shared intuition of justice? Because this question I always ask, whose justice we are talking about? When we say justice, criminal law ultimately ought to reach to that point of justice. Whose justice? Justice to accused, justice to victim, justice to society, justice to community, justice to whom? Because community's sense of justice is very different from the offender's sense of justice, our victim's sense of justice. So now we have to look at whether criminal law is addressing the varied perspectives of justice, or it is simply disposing with it. Because in many places, the instrumental justice is simply the, is identified simply because if case is disposed, so justice is delivered. All disposal of, all the time disposal of cases doesn't mean the justice has been done. Justice is something much away from the disposal of it. So despite a case is disposed, there are many aggrieved people because they don't think justice has been done. So now this is emerging, that community shared intuition of justice, because if law is common sense, then community is a stakeholder. We said in common law tradition that the law has evolved from society. So if law has evolved from the society, it has to go back to the society. So how society reacts to a wrongdoing, or how the society gets satisfied with the idea of justice, is something which is very, very important. Now, coming to this social critique and understanding the social implications, again, I would quote Noray: in a society where there is an unequal distribution of wealth, power, and principal role of criminal law in that sense, because this is like our society, where unequal distribution of wealth and power there. So in that context, what should be the role of criminal law? Role of criminal law to be the buttressing of the economic and social dispensation by legitimating state coercion against economically and less advantaged person. So criminal law ought to sort of address these diversities, which are the result of certain inequalities which are there. Now you can always ask how the provisions of criminal law can take care of. That's why a lot of protections have to be provided within the CRPC, like we are talking about legal aid. The idea of legal aid is basically the acknowledgement of inequalities in the society, where all are not equal. So Article 14 has to be given effect properly. And also the moral condemnation. Now, important thing is the functional critiques. They say the function of criminal law is to issue a moral condemnation, because the function of criminal law is stigmatization. Now, how criminal law does this function and how the criminal law dispenses this function is also reflected through community's view and not through moral philosophy. Finally, there is another critique which is very important as far as the critical criminal law is concerned, that is the feminist critique. Feminist critique has become very, very important because of a very powerful feminist studies tradition that has influenced the operation of criminal law across the globe. And therefore, I remember a very good paper by Ved Kumari, a feministic reading of Indian Penal Code, a gendered reading of Indian Penal Code. So if you start looking at how the female or women are located in the different, because generally the criminal law, when it originated, it didn't really distinguish between male and female much. But if you see the critical construct of ideal womanhood, now this is very important. If you read even the latest works, especially on gender violence or sexual violence, the legal provisions with regard to sexual assault is constructing what is called ideal womanhood. Ideal womanhood is the criminal law is applicable and constant, and it would apply if a woman behaves in a particular way. Eldridge in the US has written a book called Real Rape. It's a very controversial book. He said, ideal rape victim is one who doesn't put up enough resistance, who behaves socially well, who follows the social tradition. If any offense is conducted against that woman, then this is the ideal womanhood, and that woman deserves the adequate response from criminal justice machine. Now, this is very important critique, that you want the women to be the constant entity, and then criminal law will apply. Because right-based approach came much later, feminist movement came much later, criminal laws have already evolved much. That was one reason why the criminal laws generally lacked a very gendered and feministic orientation, except those laws which have created as a local and special life, like domestic violence and that. So I think this approach can also produce a very powerful critique. And certain propositions I will present very quickly. One is the definition of criminal responsibility. I think this critique is also, this work by Nicola Lacey, this paper is very important for anybody who is interested in this area. She is raising, what is the purpose of criminalization? She is saying that the different notions of criminal responsibilities are attributed, and then an individual's moral credibility should be considered. The role of external factors in attributing criminal responsibility can be understood only when the responsibility of the subject is questioned and his liability is justified. Now, these days we see that the sentencing process, especially in the US, they have started taking a lot of things into account as external factor in mitigating the criminal responsibility on the part of various offenders. Now, hardcore criminal law doesn't have much space, in a sense, to accommodate those factors. So now the criminal responsibility critique is very important as far as critical criminal law tradition is concerned. Now, overall, another thing I'll say while I say this. Have you ever thought, this I'm raising this to my fellow listener, all these developments in the field of critical criminal law have one thing very common. A major critique of criminal law came from one source, that initially the criminal law was the complete ownership on criminal law was of the state. The state was the owner of criminal law. Now, with the help of several Supreme Court judgments in 2018 and 2019, the primacy of the individual has again come back. And when individualized criminal law came, the individual becomes very, very important now. Therefore, you will see the direction of criminal law is changing. Because this tussle between individual liberty and the state security continues to be a very dominant theme. So I think a scholar of critical criminal law would essentially look into this balance, the extent to which the individual liberties are kept on higher pedestal, irrespective of the national security things that the state has in mind. Because all the amendments in terror laws, for instance, have been made on the pretext of the, or on the basis of national security. And therefore they have agreed to minimize or to curtail the individual rights in that process. This trend is very disturbing as far as criminal law is concerned. I think this is much debated thing, and we have to see. Because if you see important notion, Andrew, at one place he writes in his book that initially the person was the owner of he was the owner of his disputes. So my dispute is my property. My dispute is my property, and I should have say in it. Now, with the arrival of formal criminal law, the ownership of disputes of the people was taken over by this. So your disputes are not yours. The state would adjudicate your personal dispute. That is all right, because the contract theory allows us to do that. But I'm saying the individual was removed from the criminal law debate. I think reappearance of individual is a very welcome development. the Supreme Court judgment in India, even the US Supreme Court in several cases, they have kept the individual liberties at a higher pedestal. I call it reappearance of the individual on the scene of criminal law. Otherwise, 20, 30 years ago, if you see, the criminal law has become a public law in real sense. If criminal law is a public law, but essentially the individual is very important. Therefore, the Nicola is saying that the practice, the criminal law has basically a coercive mechanism to sort of regulate the community. And there is a critique also that how much criminal law is the substantial criminal law and how much criminal law is merely a regulatory community. Now, we have to come back to this discussion again that Nicola is saying there is a coercive indoctrination. The practice of transforming a person's value or belief through coercive means should be considered as a defense and reducing the criminal law. She said it is doubtful whether this coercive method would result into the transformation of a person's value or not. Because generally, we try to regulate a person's conduct in the field of criminal law by punishment. We think if a person is punished, his value or belief system would change with regard to the violation of law. There is no test that to what extent it happens. So that's why now different forms of punishments are being evolved. And therefore, we have community sentence, we have rehabilitation program, we have other kinds of things, which are very, very important. And therefore, these things have to be looked into. Now, another thing is criminal law is a moral authority. The community it governs. Again, this debate I have mentioned that Paul Robinson says it can harness the potentially powerful forces of social and normative influence. So he is saying to what extent criminal law serves as a moral authority, because ultimately all the violations on the part of people, they have certain moral questions involved. And also, this I have said that the state coercion is the major critique, because Herbert Packer say that it is the tool of regulation in the hands of the state, which can be used arbitrarily to fulfill its function. So basically, the critical criminal law scholars are mainly on this terrain, and they have reacted to a lot of repressive criminal law. Repressive criminal law, which allows the police to have a lot of power, which allows the courts to have a lot of options in adjudication. So this became a major form of critique in most countries, and a lot of writings and papers following the deletion of Herbert Packer after 1968, a lot of writings came on this issue, and they continue to maintain that the criminal law is a pain delivery mechanism. This is the phrase which is used in critical criminal law very powerfully. But that's why the NDU expert at several places say that the scholarship in all places in the field of criminal law ought to take criminal law away from merely being a pain delivery institution to become an institution which can guarantee certain rights to the people. So two types of criminal law emerges. One is liability creating criminal law, because every provision of the criminal law has a potential to create certain liability on the part of people. Now this becomes a very sort of much sought after viewpoint on the part of Indian criminal law scholars. They teach criminal law to the students to highlight that these are the liabilities which are created by the criminal. Criminal law can also be taught in terms of saying that it is a right conferring apparatus. So criminal law also confers certain rights on the people. But broadly, this part of discussion is completely missed by the scholar. So what are the entitlements which are given by the criminal law to its stakeholders? Now, this approach is arriving. And that's why I'm saying in the morning I was discussing with Sir that Andrew Ashworth has also done a very small book of 150 page around. The title of the book is Positive Obligations in Finland. Now, this book is an eye-opener in many ways because it takes you to the rights which are conferred by the criminal law, and it tells about the obligations that the state has vis-a-vis people. So criminal law dictating the obligations to the institution is a fantastic thing. And now one very important thing which I have taken from this discussion is, to what extent the teachers and the scholars in criminal law discuss the idea of omission. Criminal law in this country is discussed, analyzed, and looked at always from the viewpoint of act. Criminal law also have very important omissions. Now, omissions are basically obligation, duty to act. Now, duty to act thesis is completely missing in criminal law. Because thrill of criminal law lies in punishment, in penal consequences and all that. So that has been taken very widely by this one. But positive obligations are very sacrosanct. If you see, in the European Union, they have brought in their criminal law, in all the European countries, these obligations very clearly ingrained in the text of the criminal law. And they are dictating that this is the responsibility of the police. This is the duty. And duty to act on the part of citizen also. If a citizen fails to act in the hour of crisis, certain liability goes, because it is a public law. So I think the critical criminal law debate has to essentially move away from a liability creating criminal law to a right conferring positive obligation based criminal law. I think if you analyze this thread a little further, there is a lot of material and a lot of analysis is going into this domain, which would allow you to think criminal law as a positive criminal law, which is talking about the human liberty, which is talking. Now, there is another work by Ashworth is on preventive criminal law. Preventive criminal law is completely missed out. He's saying all the provisions of criminal law, even if you see our criminal laws, they have written keeping the prevention of crime in mind. But entire criminal law in this country has become completely reactive, as if we wait for the conduct to happen or a crime to happen, then the law will appear. So that's why declaring in advance that this is the liability for X, Y, Z conduct, which means law has to convey the preventive element of the provisions. And therefore, all the local and special laws which came from 1970 onwards, there was the prevention of corruption, or prevention of money laundering, prevention of all these laws have a prefix preventive or a prevention. But in a sense, that element of prevention was completely missed out. So Ashworth is raising this discussion that the criminal law ought to be preventive in operation and preventive in action. So probably to me, this looks very useful, area which the criminal law scholars can look at. And another, I'll quickly go through preventive regulation. This I have just discussed. Objective of criminal law has changed from rehabilitation to incapacitation. So our entire criminal law is incapacitation, because we want to incapacitate the people by confining them into the jail. But probably the criminal law is no longer rehabilitative or law. So this incapacitation as punishment vis-a-vis incapacitation for punishment debate is very, very important. Similarly, depersonalizing criminal law, this is another facet of critical criminal law theory. Depersonalizing, I have just mentioned that a personal criminal law has emerged, a personal, because person has no presence in criminal law. So there is a victimless crime, only ostensible victim is the state against whom the threat is designated. Possession offense is an example of victimless crime. So a personal criminal law is another direction. This is, again, I have just mentioned, yes, in a society where there is an unequal distribution of wealth power, the anticipated role of criminal law, this I have mentioned. But this line is very important. The criminal law has become a weapon to impose unjust laws in the socially and economically destitute sections of society in the name of the very I have said already that a lot of work on this repressive regime of criminal law has been conducted, which we can look at. And also, we can look at the historical roots of criminal law, where we have to look at inherent, irrational, and unjustified and structural aspects of criminal law. You know, at one place, I'll quote Ashworth, very interesting, he has put this sentence, he was talking about UK. When all these things I have mentioned about this, he said, a sufficiently just and logically coherent system of criminal law is an unrealistic expectation. He said, the sufficiently just and logically coherent system of criminal law is an unrealistic expectation. And he is saying that it is saying in the context of the UK society. And he is also warning our teachers in crime justice reason. At the first page, he's saying, in average classroom, when professor would walk in a class of criminal law, generally, they try to justify criminal law as a rational enterprise. Rational enterprise means we justify the force of criminal law, we justify the power given to the state. Because probably the questioning the force and power behind the criminal law and the power in the state to enforce the criminal law, it has not been a popular tradition of teaching criminal law in the state. And that is all about critical criminal law. When you are questioning the making of a particular criminal law. Professor Pandey was telling me the other day that you read a law commission working paper, which was developed before introducing the amendment into the CRPC, which came with the new CRPC in the 1973. He said a lot of exercise was done to rationalize that what is the shift. They wanted the criminal law to be freed from the hands of the state and to become it a people's law. So transition from state law to people's law. We generally have been conditioned to understand criminal law as a state law. But what is the people's law? We are a constitutional democracy. Constitution came much later. It came in 1950, these laws were created. So therefore, the basic orientation of criminal law continues to be the same. And therefore, it is said that modern criminal law was formed in a particular historical epoch. This is very important. And developed as and derived its characteristics shaped from the fundamental features of social relationship. This is what he said. So he said there is a historical continuity in the structuring of criminal law, and that has to be sort of decoded to understand the nature of criminal law. Because I have heard many times Mr. Pandey's class, and he in one of the classes says that in the beginning you need to teach the nature of criminal law. It is very important to teach the nature of criminal law before getting into the other dimension. So particular society generates a particular criminal law, I have already said. And the idea, this is another theory, which limits of criminal law, I always say with this lot of, I think this Derlach Husov work contains this theorization. It is a good idea, I suppose, the critical criminal law teachers and the students, that we are in the process of compiling the thinkers and critical criminal. because generally the thinkers in critical criminal law are very different. So we are working on a very small project to document the work of various scholars who have contributed. We are calling it thinkers in critical criminal law. And because I am deriving this theory like limits of criminal law, I think every student must read this limits of criminal law, which is very important by the Herbert Packer and followed by Douglas Husson, because he's saying, he has titled his book as Overcriminalization, the Limits of Criminal Law. Because if you see, the America is the biggest country, biggest incarcerating country in the world. So because the operation of criminal law, if you remember that the President Commission in the US recommended very forcefully that your idea of war on crime became very popular phrase in the US when criminal laws became very, very harsh with respect to a variety of crime, that resulted into over-criminalization and over-population in prisons. So America became the biggest incarcerating country in the world. And now the trend is there is a debate going on that this over-criminalization has not resulted into the curtailment of criminality in any way. So India is also sort of going into this phase, partly. And if you analyze our incarceration pattern, you will find 40% of crime, 40% of crime can be adjudicated otherwise. Means you need not to send the people behind the bar. So I don't know that we have 65% people under trial. We are also passing through this crisis. So he is saying that the state has abused its legitimate power to criminalize every petty offense, prescribing unjustified and disproportionate punishment for the sake. Now beggary was criminalized in this country. Now lockdown mein inhone sare environmental laws now criminalized, epidemic act criminalized. I asked a very question. I have written an article on over-criminalization. I can share that article. I have raised one question. I personally don't know how many laws are there in this country which have penal provisions. We generally know only criminal laws which are very popular. We know those laws, even local and special laws which have penal provisions. But we probably do not know there are host of laws which are civil in nature, like environment, There are many laws, now epidemic laws, which attract penal provisions, railway, traffic. So probably we don't know what is the number of laws which have penal provisions. This has to be, I think, looked into very carefully. So ideally, a moral wrong which prejudices the interests of society ought to be prevented in future and thus should be proscribed. This is all right. But penalizing the possession crime, homosexual intercourse, suicidal, begging, and there are lots of other things, is a trend, emerging trend in the field of over-criminalization, which we need to sort of look at. And therefore, both the scholars say criminal law is a censoring and coercive institution, and the stigma and loss of liberty of action that it may bring should be reserved for serious case. I think if I am a teacher, I'll give this sentence to the student and ask, write a note on it. This is a good question for a classroom discussion. Sometimes a seminar can be done on this. Criminal law is a censoring and coercive institution, and the stigma and loss of liberty of action that it may bring should be reserved for serious cases. So non-serious cases, again, the criminal law is a last resort. Criminal law is a last resort hearing. Sullivan has done this review of Ashworth's work, and he has written that criminal law of the last resort. Very interesting. Now, critical criminal law can develop on the notion of the theory of criminalization, contoured by seven constraints laid down by Douglas Wood. that our CRPC has a lot of interlocking reasons as far as the abuse of power by the state, by the police is concerned. But somehow the same thing is discussed here. So all the statutes must prescribe a non-trivial harm or evil constraint. Secondly, hardship and stigma may be imposed only for conduct that is some sense wrongful. Or thirdly, the violation of criminal laws that must result in punishment that are deserved. And fourthly, the burden of proof should be placed on those who advocate the imposition of criminal sanction. So he has tried to create some type of constraints in the on the criminal sanctions, and they should satisfy the demand of justice. Now, criminal law is recklessly applied. Nobody looks at the. I have asked this question in my class, and thereafter I have tried to write a. This triple talaq and other things were criminalized in India. I said, what are the principles informing the criminalization, whether harmfulness was adjudged, harmfulness was judged, or what are the implications to this? So this becomes a very important point of discussion. He identified, Douglas identified, the right not to be punished as an important aspect of his faith. He said, very nice. He said, people in this country, people in every country has a right not to be punished. It's a very important right. And he said, this right is not explicit in any constitution or any law, but he argues that the state can only influence the rights when the laws have passed the test of criminalization as founded by. But you cannot simply bring a law and bringing simply a law prescribing certain things. Unconstitutional, criminal. So this has very serious potential to invade the privacy and liberties of the people. And rest is the internal constraints that he's talking about. Three, he said those who create and maintain the punitive system are the which are the state must have a substantial interest in whatever objective the statute is designed to achieve. This has to be qualified. Substantial interest in whatever objective the statute is designed to. The law must directly advance that interest. Law must advance that interest which is behind the law. Like for instance, we invariably completely forget the preamble of objective in terms of all these laws. We have never sort of tried to judge the CRPC on the test of the principles based on which it was created. Whether have we been able to provide justice to be fair or not. This was the preamble of the CRPC in 1973. So touchstone is this. The statute must be more extensive than necessary to achieve its purpose. And then, I also have last leg of my presentation. I can then speak if required, otherwise we can have some discussion. Douglas emphasized that the indispensable need of the hour is to make criminal legislation justified on the ground of substantial state interest. Means anything which is to be criminalized must satisfy the test of substantial state interest. This is not a simple phrase, it's a very generic phrase. The state shall have a compelling and convincing interest for each criminal law it invokes. So unless you have a compelling reason, do not invoke criminal. A compelling reason is very important. A criminal statute is not necessary to accomplish on an objective if other means are available. If other means are available, a mentally retarded person is being imprisoned. Why? You should have find out other means available. There are other kinds of habitual, other kinds of psychologically disturbed or people. So criminalization of an act should only be done if the statutory objective cannot be attained without punishing the conduct. This is the main thrust of this idea. It would prevent the state from enacting thousands of acts. It would prevent the state from enacting thousands of acts as crime if an alternative non-criminal methods can be proved as efficient as decriminalization. So non-criminal. So that's why the criminal procedure model we have seen, other than Packel, there are other models. So punitive and non-punitive, basically. Non-punitive thinking in criminal law has completely disappeared because we thought that punitive sanctions would bring the desirable result. So in the territory of critical criminal law, we have to pick up those debates which are telling much more than the legal provisions themselves. One aspect I could not deal here, and which is more of a method of sort of exploring critical criminal law rather than content. In teaching some of these ideas, we tend to pick up certain Supreme Court decisions which are questioning the enforcement of law or which are questioning the law itself. Those case laws must be taken out. Like, for instance, very quickly I can quote, if you take the Jahira Sheikh case, Jahira Sheikh case, best bakery case, is one good example where the state has failed, prosecution has failed, police has failed, and judiciary has failed. But what is happening? So analyze this case and analyze this failure and provoke the student to critically reflect on the procedure, law, and the institution. That is one very good way of critical criminal law teaching. Critical criminal law teaching cannot be done unless you have critical content to offer. Take other example of, let's say, Nandini Sundar case. Or take, for example, any other case which has some critical commentary on, say, police behavior. So take those cases which have critical reflections on the institutions of the criminal law or criminal law itself. Then probably you would be a very effective teacher in evaluating. Those are take TADA or POTA. Or take, for instance, wrongful prosecution. Wrongful prosecution in Law Commission 277 report, they are questioning that law is silent when a person is wrongfully prosecuted. These are the critical aspects of the critical criminal law. So putting together all these things form to me the body of critical criminal law. We have created a syllabus. But I think the pedagogy of critical criminal law is very important. Because you have to call out, and Supreme Court cases are very important. I always say some of the cases are very helpful in evaluating the operation of criminal law on these issues. So I guess I have spoken very, very long, and I would pause here. And if there is anything to be discussed, I'm available for that. Thank you.
Any questions from the participants? Now I would request Manvain sir to express vote of thanks.
Sir, kuch kya hai? Aapka sir microphone is off, sir. Sir, mute.
Give some time to the participant for asking the question because we are having LLM students. And Professor Vajpayee, you have done,
sir,
I mean it. And I hope that they might be having several questions. They should ask.
Anything, you can ask anything. There is no bar on it.
Yeah. And then I will invite Manvin for a vote of thanks. But critical criminal law, how you can learn, how you can understand. Any question? Animesh is here. Animesh?
What is your view? There is one is coming. Sir, one question is coming. What is your view on wrongful conviction? Okay. Okay, I'll try to answer this. Wrongful conviction is an expression which is very popular, now becoming popular in the US and in the UK. So they have sort of certain cases where they found, even after conviction, certain persons were found not guilty. So in the UK, they have created a review commission which can hear the cases on merit, and certain DNA and other tests are applied. And if a person is found not guilty, there are acquittal also. And America, the Project Innocence, you please read this, it is available on the internet. Project Innocence is going worldwide, including in India, which is taking up the cases of wrongfully convicted people. Though we have not used the term wrongfully convicted people, we have used the wrongfully prosecuted people in our country. The Law Commission has used this phrase. Because we have done a case, I was in amicus in High Court on a case. So where I find, suppose one person is prosecuted by the trial court and preferred appeal in the High Court, and after 3 years he is found not guilty. So those 3 years sort of become wrongfully prosecuted, not in terms of fixing the liability on police or something, but just in terms of his suffering and all those things. So that is the idea of wrongful prosecution.
Professor Vajpayee,
yes,
in fact, I was thinking, you were talking about the state, you were talking about how the we should see the criminal law and how it should be examined critically.
Yes, sir.
But when there is a democracy in the country and people demands, J.S. Verma report, and after that, whole amendment in the IPC. And it took away every possibility of the rehabilitation. Even it went up to the execution. And that too on the people's demand. Legal realism and the social realism, they both coincide for the punitive actions. How you explain it? Because when a student asks this question in the classroom, and I am, because Douglas, Andrew Ashworth, you see, it's okay. But when it comes to reality, I agree with you, because nowadays I am just, students, these questions should have come from your side. LLM students, we are working very hard. Your teachers are working very hard with you. And Vajpayee will go and say none of the students ask any question.
Sir, there are questions actually.
Yeah, please.
They have raised a lot of questions here, which are coming in my chat box.
Okay. That's good. Then I'm sorry.
No. There are questions, I think. So I'll first try to. I also don't have really answer for this particular question, but I can say one thing, that in India, we have experienced a very difficult situation. On the one hand, we have a system which is very conventional and orthodox. As far as the liberal traditions are concerned, the criminal law continues to be very, very conservative. And the criminal justice system is sort of faced with a challenge which is coming from liberal traditions and works which are being done elsewhere, which are talking about rehabilitation, restorative justice, and other forms of non-punitive measures. I always face this question, how to reconcile the liberal solutions to humanize the criminal justice system in India? I think the real test, even I ask the judges, so judges say that we are working in a system, in a legal system, which does not provide them much scope to experiment with those ideas which are debated here and there and which have been imported to this country from all over, and they are very fascinating and they are worth trying. But somehow this system is inherently and is structurally deficient to accommodate that kind of new wave of thinking and thought. answer would be that there is a need to create some space for this this kind of experimentation in India by sort of creating some spaces for these experiments. Like I can give you an example. In restorative justice model is discussed very often. This is very important, rehabilitative, reformative, and very reconciling. A study we have done by way of a survey in cases of juveniles, especially in cases of POXO, can there be a scope to have a restorative model where the parties can come together and negotiate the matter? There were quick reactions. They said, no, this is a heinous offense, we cannot do. But when I asked the people, that we have done a survey, we have documented, there is a book I can share with you. It contains a very mixed reaction. They are saying, despite having found a person guilty by the court, I'm saying this is the expression of the family. Family is saying, I have seen the person walking, smiling on us, and he's going to the prison for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. It doesn't matter. He doesn't have any sense of remorse. Acknowledgement of guilt is not something that you can make it by way of law. And sometimes people want the acknowledgement of wrongdoing on the part of offender to be done publicly to the victim part. They want the victim to acknowledge the wrong done to the victim. This is a expectation. But law can punish, but acknowledgement is not. I can go jail, but I don't consider myself guilty. This is the family sense of justice. Individual sense of justice. So I think we need to create, I think, as I said, a lot of laws, a lot of provisions, 40% are such, where other forms of punishments are possible. Rehabilitation is not inbuilt in our system. There is no rehabilitation mechanism. You have left the rehabilitation to the prison. Prison is a merely custodial institution. Indian prisons were never created to reform the offenders, nor they are doing now. Because we have never created a system which can sort of really do this exercise. So unfortunately, these things cannot be done unless systems are created. Therefore, law reform and law institutions reform in this. There are two different things. Sometimes law is reformed, but the institutions of law are not reformed. So I think there has to be a very clear mandate. Like police is not mandated to do certain things which we expect. Like for instance, victim, police is not supposed to heal anything done to the victim legally. Police has no mandate, nor they are duty bound. So I think we have to revisit the entire vision and mission of the agencies of criminal justice system by way of reforming the law at appropriate places and casting that duty on the police. In several places it has been done. So with this, I just look at a few questions. Amit, who can read these questions? Are you also able to read some of the questions? Myself showing show also we have been popular was going on today. Arrest during lockdown period in the state of UP because of unlawful arrest. The detention is not only the cause of loss of year, but also so how can we crucially examine the issue as to what there is a legal remedy here? So wrongful arrest is being discussed here. I think a very important thing I would say as far as the arrest law is concerned, you know, section 41 has been amended significantly, which deals with the law of arrest. And 41 A, B, C is now available. And you can see the idea of introducing amended 41 was to minimize the instances of arrest. How you can do and how can you do this? I think you take any police station in your locality, go there and find out in how many cases the requirement of notice was complied by the police before making the arrest as provided in 41A. Compliance of notice is not simply a mechanical arrangement made in the section 41. It is a very important protection provided to the arrestee, potential arrestee. It's a protection. So what I'm saying, sometimes these things are not complied with by the police. So I think the compliance of law, I always say very fascinating thing I would say. The moment you go to the compliance of law, you have to do an empirical study. Compliance of law can only be done by empirical study. Why don't you do a small study in the city of Jabalpur, take one police station and look at how often the police is complying with the requirement of notice in the event of arrest. I have done this study, I have taken my student, and I came to know that law in context, again, rhetoric of the law and reality of the law. Rhetoric of law is written in the law, but reality of law is located in the society. So when you look at the rhetoric of law, that is fine. But to reality of law, do a small project. Take 5-6 students, choose a police station, go and see the compliance of law. The moment you start looking at the compliance of any section of law, it will provide you a lot of substance. So this is my answer to you, Harshit. Now,
Vajpayee, here I would like to intervene.
Yes, please.
My research team, because Ashutosh, Anmesh, Gautam Gupta, and Achyut, only day before yesterday, we organized a seminar cum workshop here in our university. Yes. And we invited police officers, judicial officers, and I'm happy that IG, DIG, SP, Deputy SPs, and District Judge, and the CJM, and the judicial magistrates were here. And the question which you have raised, because we collected data, I'm thankful to my research team, they collected that in Jabalpur, around 965 arrests were made. And the question which you are asked, and those arrests were under section 188 of IPC for flouting the orders of the competent authority. And they said... FIR was registered and they were arrested. And then they further tried to find out some FIR were written 188 plus 34. So that is not possible because section 34 and section 188 can't go together. Again, the question was, because the legal issue was what you are raising here, arrest and the FIR. 195 of the Criminal Procedure Code provides that no magistrate shall take cognizance without the complaint filed by the public servant and the that public servant who issued that particular order or anybody superior to him. So Section 188 cannot be invoked until and unless the court has not ordered on the basis of the complaint made by a public servant. This question is hanging. But the problem is, because the way we were discussing the things, the matter went in Supreme Court and there are three cases in Supreme Court. And in all these three cases, Supreme Court said that this filing of the FIR and the arrest is a separate process and taking the cognizance of the offense is a separate process. And there, they made it, they justified the police because they can file the FIR and they can arrest a person. Second thing, Madhya Pradesh High Court has been very categorical from the day one. First case was Jyotiraj Sindhia and then again and then in 2020, January 2020, one case has been defined by Madhya Pradesh High Court. They are of the opinion, and now you see, nowadays some sort of differences are coming up from the different high courts and the Supreme Court and the High Court. Madhya Pradesh High Court is saying Section 188 and Section 195, if they are read together, then filing of the FIR is void ab initio by the police on the basis of the information. What discussion we are making, critical criminal law. Why they are doing it?
Yes.
Because to break the chain of the corona. Why they are doing it? Because they want to create a fear, or they want to tell them that they should remain inside home. And in all the FIR, the story was the same. So question what you are raising is very critical. And I think when Vikram Singh filed a PIL before the Supreme Court, there are 5 lakhs people. 5 lakhs people were arrested in Tamil Nadu. Okay. 40,000 people have been arrested in Uttar Pradesh. Okay. 20,000 people have been arrested in Jabalpur. And in none of the cases, notice was given by the police under punishment. And same thing is Epidemic Act. Okay. Even the ordinance. So you have rightly said, and I hope that our students will try to comprehend, and they will try to learn the critical criminal law the way we want to tell them. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your encouraging words. I'm really thankful to all for giving me this opportunity to speak to you today.
Sir, I would request Manvain sir to express vote of thanks.
अनम्यूट करो मानवेंद्र अपने को प्लीज अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ
या थैंक यू वेरी मच सो इट इज एन ऑनर एंड प्रिविलेज टू हैव द अपॉर्चुनिटी टू लिसन टू प्रोफेसर जीएस वाजपेयी आई हैव सो फार ओनली रेड हिज आर्टिकल्स But this is for the first time that I got the opportunity to also hear him. On behalf of Dharmashastra National Law University and on behalf of our leader, Professor Balraj Chauhan, faculty members, and most importantly, our students, and most importantly, the students of critical criminal law who are presently in our LLM first year, I would like to extend a very heartfelt gratitude towards Professor G.S. Vajpayee. For having spared his valuable time for us and given all of us who have the privilege of listening to him an opportunity to actually comprehend the various contours and nuances of this discipline, which he himself says is an emerging one, that is critical criminal law. I have personally benefited a lot from what he told us today. Since I study and teach jurisprudence, a lot of what he actually talked about was actually music to my ears, because he talked about the historical critique, the normative critique, and the functional critique, and the fact that this critical actually comes from the discipline of jurisprudence, wherein critical legal studies emerged. I would personally also like to read this particular area of critical criminal law, and hopefully maybe from next year if I'm allowed, I would like to class of critical criminal law, such has been the encouragement and inspiration provided by the words of Professor Vajpayee. So once again, I thank Professor Vajpayee on behalf of the team of Dharmashastra National Law University. And thank you very much to Professor, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Balraj Chauhan, the team led by Ashutosh and our students, for having given us the opportunity to actually connect and listen to Professor Vajpayee. Thank you very much, sir. We are honored and privileged. Thank you for having me. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Vajpayee. Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.